Welcome, and thank you so much for joining us for this exciting event. My name is Laura Mickham, and I'm the director of the Sallie Bingham Center for Women's History and Culture at Duke University. I want to mention that if my internet connection becomes unstable, I will ask Bingham Center librarian Kelly Wooten to read the following logistical remarks and to introduce Sallie Bingham. We'll also paste them into the chat, as it's a lot of information. We will be recording this event. Ms. Bingham's readings and talk will last about 40 minutes, after which we will open up to a question and answer period. You can type your questions in the Q&A, which you can open by clicking Q&A at the bottom of your screen. And when the Q&A opens, I will moderate the discussion by selecting questions for our speaker. We ask for your understanding if we have technical issues, awkward pauses, or any other problems. If our speaker's internet connection becomes unstable or freezes, we'll ask you for your patience as we work to resolve this. If this does not work or we have other disruptions that we cannot resolve, we will end the meeting with the hopes of recording the talk and sharing it with all who registered. If you'd like to stay in touch with the Sallie Bingham Center for Women's History and Culture, we're providing links to join our mailing list, to receive our newsletter, and to follow our social media channels. To purchase the books from which Ms. Bingham will read today, please follow the links that will also be pasted in a moment into the Q&A or into the chat. It is now my great pleasure to introduce writer, teacher, feminist activist, and generous and visionary philanthropist, Sallie Bingham. About her life as a writer, Ms. Bingham has said, "I'd been writing since I literally could write. Terrifying ghost stories my first grade class was persuaded to perform in sheets. Sentimental poems sent to my father overseas in World War II, short stories that began to win prizes by the time I was in high school, the Dana Reed Prize at Harvard for best undergraduate writing, the first time it was given to a woman, and a request from editor Ann Barrett at Houghton Mifflin to see a novel. In 1961, not long after Bingham graduated from college, Houghton Mifflin published that novel. It was followed by 6 more novels, 5 collections of short stories, 3 collections of poetry, numerous plays, 3 works of nonfiction, including The Silver Swan, In Search of Doris Duke, from which she will be reading today. Gloria Steinem said of Silver Swan, quote, "Men who inherit great wealth are respected, but women who do the same are ridiculed. In The Silver Swan, Sallie Bingham rescues Doris Duke from this gendered prison and shows us just how brave, rebellious, and creative this unique woman really was and how her generosity benefits us to this day." According to the New York Times review, quote, "Bingham adds a trove of new material to the Duke oeuvre, including revealing quotations from letters and details of daily life on Duke's many estates." Bingham will also read from her latest book, Treason, A Sallie Bingham Reader, a collection that captures the spirit of the author's illustrious writing career via short stories, a novella, and a play. From the complex stories of artistic influence and the exhilaration and fright of solitude to the incendiary rage of a betrayed young wife who sacrifices everything for revenge, to the struggles for independence of the 3 women who surrounded Ezra Pound like subservient stars, these fictions seize the reader's attention while slashing stereotypes. Bingham's writings have appeared in the Atlantic Monthly, New Letters, Plains Woman, Plain Song, Greensboro Review, Negative Capability, the Connecticut Review, and Southwest Review, amongst others, and have been anthologized in many collections, such as Best American Short Stories, 40 Best Stories for Mademoiselle, Prize Stories, the O. Henry Awards, and the Harvard Advocate Centennial Anthology. In addition, Ms. Bingham has worked as an author and critic in a number of organizations, including as a book editor for the Louisville Courier-Journal, a guest editor at Mademoiselle, just a few years after Sylvia Plath held that same post, and a director of the National Book Critics Circle. As a part of her long and profound commitment to enhancing and documenting women's lives, Bingham co-founded Women's Project and Productions, the nation's oldest and largest company dedicated to producing and promoting theater created by women, the Kentucky Foundation for Women, an organization that promotes positive social change by supporting varied feminist expression in the arts, and of course, the Sallie Bingham Center for Women's History and Culture right here at Duke University. Describing her oeuvre in 2011, Publishers Weekly observed that, quote, Bingham's work remains sharp and deliciously unsettling, ripe for discovery by a new generation of readers. It is clear that Silver Swan and Treason certainly bear this out. Please join me in welcoming Sallie Bingham. Sallie, I invite you to start.
Thank you so much, Laura. I had forgotten most of those things, so I was very glad to be reminded. I've been very fortunate to have a long career as a writer, and in many ways, the best aspect of it is the most recent in the publication of these two books. I'm going to talk, first of all, and read to you from The Silver Swan. The subtitle is In Search of Doris Duke, which of course implies that I never found her, which is always possible for a biography, published by Farrar, Straus, and Giroux last April. Most people who know a little about Doris Duke consider her a colorful eccentric. I prefer to call her an original. And certainly the most colorful aspects of her privileged life, owning two camels, twining hibiscus flowers in their manes, traveling all over the world, wearing couture clothes at times, visiting Gandhi in India, are fun to read about. But that's not what motivated me to write a serious literary biography of a woman widely misunderstood during her life and even now. Instead, I want to discover what motivated a privileged, protected, upper-class white woman to pursue passionately, first of all, her goal of reporting for the press in the final days of the World War II in Italy. In spite of many obstacles, including obstruction from the U.S. State Department. As she explained in one of her very rare interviews, this was an interview with her friend Mike Shiningo for an article called Doris Duke, Learning to Be a Reporter. When Shiningo asked her why she wanted to be a reporter, she replied that she felt compelled to do something worthwhile with her life. She added that her friend, the writer Claire Booth Luce, had sparked the idea when she was visiting Doris in Hawaii back in 1941. Doris told Shiningo that she had been preparing for the job by studying and then rewriting news stories. She said she understood that she might not be taken seriously by editors since she had no previous experience as a reporter. She knew she would have to establish herself as a responsible professional by proving that she could observe accurately and write persuasively, and that she succeeded in doing. We often struggle today to understand the disinterest of inheritors, of whom we have more and more, some of them now women, how to inspire them to take on the work of the world to which they have so much to contribute due to their resources, and to move beyond their class's traditional funding of the arts and of large buildings bearing their names. The answer, I think, is in the development of curiosity and a certain fearlessness, both of which inspired some of Doris Duke's boundary-pushing donations, such as early support of the birth control movement, at that time it was illegal, through her friend Margaret Sanger, and years later, her support of the Rosebud Sioux in South Dakota. On December 2nd, 1958, in a letter to Dear Madam, Antoine Robidoux, secretary of the Rosebud Sioux Council, wrote that he was sending her a tribal certificate, adopting her as a member of the tribe and giving her the name Wakantiyeyewin, or Princess Charity. This name would celebrate her as a generous and caring woman who helped one of the poorest Native American tribes in the country. Moved by this appreciation, Doris decided to visit. At her naming ceremony on the reservation in South Dakota, she wore her beaded doeskin regalia, the bait embroidered with her first name. A blurred snapshot shows her smiling broadly. This regalia is at Rough Point in Newport. Doris's curiosity about the tribes may have been aroused decades earlier, when her beloved younger brother Walker sent her an undated postcard from a summer trip to Yosemite. The postcard shows a teepee with several Indians lying around it. Walker's message read that he felt sorry for these Blackfoot Indians. They had told him they had no blankets for the winter. The same curiosity and daring that fueled her many trips around the world led her to the creation of the extraordinary collection of Islamic art now housed at her house in Hawaii, Shangri-La, which is called the Center for Islamic Culture, as she endowed it in her will. And it also led her to explore the forgotten neighborhood in Newport and the preservation of the humble wooden houses there through her Newport Restoration Society. This is a long cry from the big houses like Rough Point, the house she inherited from her parents, which she also preserved. But these are not the big houses on Ocean Avenue. First of all, she would have to find this neighborhood. Walking the narrow sidewalk, she would have seen ragged one-story cottages that once housed sailors, sea captains, harbor masters, craftsmen, and tradespeople. Built cheek by jowl on busy streets and lacking gardens and gates, these houses were too small to interest the wealthy as summer homes. Other individuals had saved a few houses, but Doris's vision was larger. In 1968, she founded the Newport Restoration Foundation, still going strong, to restore and preserve whole sections of two neighborhoods on the downsloping streets that led to the harbor. Once established, the Newport Restoration Foundation bought, restored, and saved 72 houses, a remarkable achievement that stands out in the history of American preservation for its scope and prescience. In these small houses lived the people who in the 18th and early 19th century practiced the essential crafts of a thriving harbor community. But no life of any scope is without its shadows. Doris's relationship with men, including dark-skinned men far removed from her social surroundings in New York, led to scandalous rumors, perhaps partly because she was always the first one to leave. And her adoption of Shandi Hefner at the end of her life and their falling out led to years of legal wrangling over Doris's will. The death of a close companion in an accident interpreted by some as murder continues to inspire vindictive rumors. Relying on the local sheriff's report and what I have come to know of Doris's character, I believe Eddie's death was a tragic accident. But the rumors will persist, based, I think, on our distrust of women who exercise the power of their money. Now, how did I begin to become interested in Doris Duke? This was many, many, many years ago. And I'll read you a little bit of this preface. In the late summer of 1958, I was a shy, nearly silent 21-year-old, awkwardly adjusting to my honeymoon with my young husband, when he took me to a formal luncheon in a grand apartment in Paris. His father moved in that world. I had no idea what to expect. Raised in privilege, but in Kentucky, I spoke only a little French, and as a beginning writer, had little confidence. Although my mother had worked hard to teach me how to conduct myself at such adult occasions, a mixture of reticence and inchoate rebellion had caused me to resist learning her useful lessons beyond shaking hands and murmuring a few polite inanities. Yet there I was, sitting at the long dining room table with 10 or 12 dark-suited French gentlemen on either side. The lunch consisted of four courses passed by silent waiters in livery. My shyness made me afraid of choking, and I hardly dared touch a drop of the three kinds of wine. Embroidered linen napkins and crystal and silver glinting in the dim Paris sunlight did nothing to make me yet feel at home. And there is no master of the house sitting at the other end of the table. Instead, very far from me reigned a distinguished presence, a woman of a certain age, filled with power, authority, and dignity, such as I had never encountered. What she wore, or even what she looked like or said, escaped my attention. I was overwhelmed, fascinated, and frightened by her sheer presence. I don't believe we exchanged a single word. Later, my husband told me that our hostess was Doris Duke, an heiress and a philanthropist. Decades later, I visited Duke University in Durham, North Carolina, endowed and named by Doris Duke's father after his family, and I noticed that in the lobby of the Washington Duke Inn, there were black marble busts of many of the Duke men, but there was nothing of Doris Duke. I hope you will be intrigued enough to want to read more of this biography. Now I'm going to make a transition to read from my other 2020 book, a collection called Treason, a Sallie Bingham Reader, published by Saraband Books. This collection is composed of my play Treason, produced off-Broadway at the Perry Street Theater, three short stories, and a novella. The collection covers a broad swath of my 50-year-long writing career. The linking thread is the question of influence. Doris Duke never had a mentor. Unable to relate to the early 20th century women's movement, she never had the leadership it might have provided. She had to discover her own inner agency over time, always under the terrible question posed by her inheritance of a fortune partly based on tobacco, although also on hydroelectric power in the Southeast. In Treason, my play, the three women, wife, mistress, and daughter, who spent their lives taking care of the poet Ezra Pound, also lacked for mentors who might have led them to question their devotion to a cruel and careless man. This is the treason I wrote about in my play, rather than Pound's political treason that almost led to his hanging after World War II. Too often, it seems to me, we women devote enormous time and energy to supporting unworthy men whom the world has persuaded us are important. We see many examples today. My play ends with Pound near death admitting, "I never made anyone happy." Too late to do any good, but a reminder to all of us about what really counts. My three short stories in the collection Treason also hinge on aspects of betrayal and the absence of mentors. In Swings, a lonely woman named Martha finds solace in a brief flirtation with a circus aerialist, Evan Dale, who gives her a swing for her garden and hangs it up. Martha's neighbor, Mrs. Whiteside, is watching. Em and Dale climbed to the highest branch on the big beech, and Martha climbed up after him. They were so high, Mrs. Whiteside felt dizzy looking at them. And Martha's daughter, Sissy, on the ground, started calling to her mother to come down. Evan Dale balanced himself on the branch and opened his bag, and Mrs. Whiteside saw it contained a long, curled-up rope. He squatted down and dropped one end of the rope over the limb and tied it with a quick knot. And then Martha handed him the other end and he hitched it in the same way. Martha climbed down and brought a board out from the garage, and Evan Dale fixed it in the loop of the rope. He pressed down with both hands to see if the seat was secure, and then he stood back and looked at Martha. She backed herself up to the board and sat down. By now the light was fading, and all Mrs. Whiteside could plainly see was Martha's long white feet pointed toward the top of the tree. She had shuffled off her shoes. Evan Dale gave her one hard push and then watched her swing. Sissy stood and stared. After a while, he folded the bag and put it under his arm and started out of the yard, leaving the ladder and the toolbox where they lay. Mrs. Whiteside didn't see him leave, but she heard the car start. Martha went on swinging. After a while, Sissy went into the house and lights sprang on in the windows. Later, the other girl, Judy, came out and called her mother, but Martha went on swinging. In another story in this collection called Grand Canal, a young girl, Matilda, learns about the practice of art from her father, a painter, during a trip to Venice. Years later, studying his painting of the Grand Canal, she remembers her disillusionment when she learned how her father actually painted. But the experience of his painting and her own genius leads her to a career as a photographer. Betrayal sometimes leads to wisdom. This is a description of her studying her father's painting many years after it was actually done. Years ago, blue water, yes, obviously blue, although you remember it as a little murky. Didn't all the sewers and drains of Venice empty into it? Lined on both sides with the peach, melon, lemon, and linen gray of the old three-story balconies. There are balconies hung with unnameable flowers, their peaked roofs crowding the sky. And now you can't avoid it, Matilda. You must lower your eyes and study those shapes he painted on the water. Seven of them, gondolas, yes. You must name them. There's no avoiding it now. With the gondolas comes the stink of sentimentality, striped shirts across brawny shoulders, leghorn hats with fluttering ribbons, some sort of song tossed onto the water. And whether you want it or not, Matilda, you are 15 years old again, standing on that bridge, the old bridge, the Ponte Vecchio, with your little camera slung from your neck and held proudly in both hands, and he is beside you. Finally, I want to talk about the novella, Upstate, that is also included in this collection. I take on an uncomfortable subject in this novella, a woman's rage. Even today, years after the three successive waves of the women's movement, rage is not an acceptable feeling for women and must be suppressed. This story is particularly dangerous because I wrote it in the first person, leading inevitably to misunderstandings. The narrator, long married with three children, has fallen in love with her best friend's husband. After a summer of deceit and betrayal in upstate New York, she decides to divorce her husband and sell their house. During an auction of the contents, she displays her ruthlessness, which comes to a climax when she sets her fleeing lover's house on fire. And I'll read this passage towards the end of the novella. I start down the path towards the house. A little smoke is climbing out of the chimney from Edwin, that's her lover, Edwin's early morning fire, left banked against their return. How fragile the house looks, how defenseless and pretty, with its green shutters and dormer windows. It's like an illustration in a child's book, a house of rabbits, all Edwin's handiwork. There's the terrace he laid himself next to the front door, the flower bed he dug for his wife, the window boxes he hammered together so that she could have her petunias. They are thriving still, falling over the edges of the boxes in long white and purple sprays. I walk around the north side of the house where I'm out of sight of the road. The handle of my gasoline can is cutting into my fingers. I set it down on the grass and unscrew the top, then realize I have no matches. Leaving the gasoline can, I slide open the front porch door and step inside. There's the familiar chaos and the smell of burnt bacon. Tennis rackets and children's boots are heaped on the floor. I hear the tap dripping on the plates in the kitchen sink. The table is covered with the remains of their breakfast, chairs pushed back as though they had all rushed out on impulse in the midst of toast and tea. Flora's heart-shaped silver tea strainer is winking in the sun. I know she keeps her matches in the drawer next to the stove. I take the box. Out through the kitchen where we made fruitcake 3 Novembers running, Edwin giving us each a boiled dime to drop into the big bowl of batter. We were all his children then. Out through the porch, I stumble on Frank's knapsack, bulging with school books. Down the steps to the gasoline can, shining red in the sun. Tipping the can, I sprinkle the geraniums growing along the house. Their fleshy leaves do not absorb the gasoline. It spatters, staining the paint. The acrid smell overwhelms the citrusy smell of the geraniums blooming in the sun. I tip the can up again and soak the leaves and the grass. Cool air touches my cheek like a set of fingers, and I look up the hill and see the bright trees behind the children's swing. It is a beautiful day. I strike a match against the strip of sandpaper, throw it into the geraniums, and jump back. With a gush, a big flame flares up. And to discover what happens after this extraordinary act, you will have to buy the collection, Treason. To finish, I want to thank the people and the institutions that made these two books possible. First of all, the Bingham Center and the Rubenstein Library at Duke University, and also the Doris Duke Charitable Foundation, which gave me permission to use the big archive of Doris Duke's papers that is at Duke for my research. And Treason owes its very existence to a remarkable publisher, Sarah Band Books. I am deeply grateful to all. Now I would be delighted to answer any questions.
Thank you, Sally. That was just grand. Absolutely wonderful. And Kelly has invited people to type their questions into the Q&A. So I invite you to do that. So as people are typing, I had a couple questions I thought we could start with, if you're open to that.
Please.
So it was an amazing adventure that I got to watch from a bit of a distance over the years as you did research in the many Doris Duke collections that are at Duke. I wonder if you would favor us with a story or two of your experience of exploring those collections.
Well, since I've never written a biography before, I've never done any research before, and this was just fascinating to me. Every time I would want a certain box brought up from the depths, this box would appear promptly, in which there were at that time, I don't know if it's still done that way, these manila file folders full of what were clearly personal papers. This was the handwriting of individuals, not particularly Doris Duke because she didn't write very much, but all her friends and acquaintances, people who had worked for her, in addition to articles from magazines and newspapers about her. So it was like diving into the richest store of gems you can imagine. Each time I pulled out carefully one of these manila file folders, I felt as though I was literally laying my hands on her life. Most exciting, and I don't think I will ever be able again to avoid subjects that involve me in research. However, I suppose I won't have the great opportunity of doing the research where I did for this book.
Lovely. So we had a question that actually mimics one of my own questions, which is about your novella and the observation you made about it, about being, that you wrote it in the first person and that that was risky and could lead to misunderstanding or questions. And the questioner would like you to elaborate on that.
Well, I think everyone has trouble believing that fiction is fiction, probably particularly in books written by women. Readers often tend to assume that it's just thinly disguised autobiography. And when you write in the first person, that may lead people to think, well, this is the writer's story. She's writing it in the first person. This is her. Instead of understanding that it's a created and imagined persona that has this story. I must say that when it was first published, my then agent was so deeply bothered and distressed by this novella that he told me that he wouldn't send it out to publishers unless I wrote a coda. And I said, well, what should be in the coda? And he said, she has to go see a psychiatrist.
Oh my God.
So needless to say, that I wasn't particularly interested in that being the summation because I honestly don't think this narrator is insane. I think she's, you could say, insanely angry, but she has rather good reasons to be angry. She's been really brutally betrayed. And I tend to think that although I would not justify burning down a house, I would justify many other expressions of anger, because often we have many reasons to be angry.
Oh, I totally agree with that. Another questioner congratulates you on the Silver Swan and observes how impressed she is with how much you glean from papers that actually didn't include very much of Doris's own writings. And she wanted to know if you would comment on that particular challenge.
That was a huge challenge. In fact, when I first realized it, and this was after I had signed a contract to write the biography, and when I saw going through the files that there was almost nothing of Doris's own writing. She never kept a journal, as far as I know. She didn't even write very many letters. And I was taken aback. I thought, maybe this is impossible. Maybe I should say I just can't write this biography. But then as I discovered how rich the other letters were in their references to her and their comments about her, I thought it's going to be possible to weave her personality together from other people's impressions. Now that is dangerous. Other people may be misguided. They may have prejudices of certain kinds, but I did feel that it was worth doing because it allowed her story to be told in the only way it really could be told, because if I had waited, or if anyone had waited in hope of finding what she had written about herself, there never would be a biography.
Understood. Another attendee thanks you so much for sharing the readings that you shared today and wants to know if Doris's life inspired you before you undertook the research. Were you already inspired by her, or was the inspiration mostly from what you learned in the archives, or both?
Well, I can't say she inspired me, because I was already deeply involved in philanthropy. Had been for some years before I began working on this book. And it's been in my bones and in my veins, I think, really since I was a child, the feeling that to someone who is given great means, inherited money is never earned, as we know, and often it's not even deserved. The only justification is to give a large part of it to the betterment of the world, and in my case, to the betterment of women's lives. What she did inspire me with, though, is she was, I think, a good deal more daring than I am. And it's always good to have the example of a woman who takes greater risks. Now, some of these risks had unpredictable and even unfortunate results, but it's inspiring to see, well, just in terms of her swimming, she swam into advanced middle age. She was one of the first surfers, white women surfers in Hawaii. And in fact, her wetsuit is at Rough Point. Just to feel that she took risks, that she dared, was in itself inspiring to me.
Absolutely. Another person asks about your experience writing biographies versus writing novels and how they inform each other.
They do inform each other. If you can't write a biography unless you use your imagination, there are just going to be a lot of holes in any story when you must use your research and your imagination to fill that hole. Gaps in time, gaps in motivation, gaps in circumstance. And that's what we do in a novel. A novel, in a sense, begins as all holes, because there is no research. And strengthening my imagination through the writing of 7 or 8 novels, I think really helped me with the biography. Now, of course, here you run into dangerous territory, because if you rely too heavily on your imagination, and also if you're not well enough informed, you may make egregious mistakes, and you can be sure someone is going to spot them. But I think assuming that you have good research under your belt and also the experience of writing fiction, it's a strength.
Absolutely. Another person has asked if you might comment on ways in which your life has been similar to Doris Duke's and how it has been different. And did any of the similarities encourage you to do the research and write the biography?
Well, the main difference is I don't have that much money. That's a huge difference. But also, I was born and raised in the South, or at least in Kentucky, which is more Southern than has any right to be. Doris Duke was never spent any time in the South, even though her father and mother were both Southerners and her father maintained his ties with North Carolina. She was really an internationalist, and I have never been that. I've traveled a fair amount, but I've never been as comfortable, particularly in countries that are very unfamiliar to me, as she was. Beyond that, I was fortunate in having what we would call a good education, graduated from Radcliffe College with a BA in English. Doris, and this was a great regret for her, never had even a high school education, because her mother was opposed to it. That's a major difference. And I think one of the reasons Doris did not write very much was she was not really very confident about her ability to write a good sentence, and perhaps even to make a spelling mistake. If you can imagine what it would be like to be as prominent as she was without even a high school degree, you can imagine how abashed that might have made her feel. I've been very lucky in being able to ground myself in my education and, of course, in continuing education and reading. So that's a major difference. The other thing that is different is that her father died when she was 12, just about 13. My father lived until I was into late middle age, and so did my mother. So she lost her father's influence very early, whereas I had my father's influence for most of my life.
I understand. So I wonder if in your travels, in your research, either at Duke or elsewhere, you learned anything more about Doris's involvement in the birth control movement or the women's liberation. She was not really involved in the women's liberation movement, but in the birth control movement in particular, and her friendship with Margaret Sanger.
It was interesting to me because when she was born was actually when she was 7 years old was the time of the great suffrage marches on Fifth Avenue. And since she was living in a house on the corner of Fifth and 78th Street, she would have had to have been aware of them. However, as far as I can tell, she never met any of the women leading the women's movement of that time, never expressed any particular interest in the women's movement. Her life, I think, is an example of feminism in a very, you could say, inarticulate way, in that she used her money as she wanted to use it. She was very independent. And that, in a sense, is what feminism is all about, even though she never really espoused what we believe is feminist, or at least if she did, she never spoke about it or wrote about it.
A couple of other questions about Doris. What fascinated you about Doris Duke that is critical for women today to understand and to emulate?
That's a complicated question. I think what fascinated me about her was her risk-taking. And that I would perhaps hesitate to advocate for all women. Many women are not in a position to take any risks. They're already too precarious, may not have a stable source of income, may not have a stable family or an insured career, and in which case you're not really in a position to take a lot of risks. But for those of us fortunate enough to be secure in privilege, and that don't mean a privilege depending on an enormous amount of money, the privilege of class, the privilege of whiteness, it's very important for us to take risks because we can afford it. And it's the only way we learn and grow.
Absolutely. Another attendee comments that my impression is that Doris Duke was a lonely person who had a problem trusting people. Is it your impression that she did have a group of friends who really did have her best interests at heart?
Well, she certainly had a group of friends and she was not lonely. I mean, she may have been lonely in the depths of night the way we all are, but she was not lonely for lack of friends. One of my favorite descriptions of her is late in life when she was living in Los Angeles. She had a good woman friend who used to come for Sunday lunch. And after lunch, these two women would read the parts in Lavender and Old Lace. I don't know if anyone remembers that play, but that's a comedy about wicked old women. I wouldn't say that all of her friends had her best interests at heart, but then who can say of all their friends that they have their best interests at heart? But she was very close to a lot of people, not only her friends from her social life, but she was very close to a lot of the people who worked for her. She admired the work of working people. And in fact, when she was doing some of the redesign of Duke Gardens in New Jersey, the old greenhouses needed the wooden benches taken out because they were rotten. It was a very hot summer day in New Jersey. And the men who were working there were getting really tired of laboring on in the heat, but she was right there helping them to pull out these old wooden benches so they couldn't very well give up and stop. This to me, this is one of many examples of the way she connected with people. She always connected with people. But it's one of the misunderstandings of her story that people think she was lonely and isolated.
So turning to Treason, if we might, I wonder if you would talk to us a little bit about the process of creating that book and that compilation.
I really have to thank my publisher at Saraband Books, Sarah Gorham. It was initially her idea to put together this collection. And she was very helpful to me in choosing among so much material what she felt made sense and hung together. I did withdraw one story that she wanted to include, and I sort of regret that now. It's a story called Luke, set in a very different time and very different place in the South. And at this point, the way we are feeling right now about Black Lives Matter, it might have been a story that offended a good many people. But other than that, I think she was, and I wish Sarah was here to speak about this, but I think she was very interested in showing the range of my writing from a play about a literary figure of 50 years ago, Ezra Pound, through these stories about contemporary life, in the case of Swing's contemporary life in a small town, through the whole issue of international travel and international influence, which is what's going on in the Grand Canal, and then a very raw story about childbirth called New Life, and the novella, which everybody had been so frightened of or by, that I was quite amazed when Sarah decided that she wanted to take it on. But she is herself a fearless soul, which is one reason why she's such a fine editor and publisher. I don't think anything intimidates her. So it really was a collaboration. It wasn't me making a selection and sending it to her. We worked on that together. She also did some very important fine tuning and editing of everything in the handbook. So it is very much a collaboration. And I think with any collection, that's important. You don't really have enough objectivity as a writer to put together a collection without really a great deal of input from your publisher editor.
Sarah has just written in to say that she agrees that it was a wonderful collaboration. And I just want to warmly congratulate you. I just think it's very, very exciting that there is a Sallie Bingham Reader that has just been published, having known you for as long as I have.
Yes.
Lovely to see that that particular milestone is very, very exciting. I also want to share that your wonderful archivist, Elizabeth Dunn, the archivist of the Doris Duke Papers, commented earlier that your description of working in the papers is the most poetic description of archival research that she has ever heard, which is remarkable because she's heard a lot in her career, I can tell you. So that was another wonderful collaboration, yours with Elizabeth.
Yes, it was. And I was such a newbie. And I think in many other libraries, I would have felt kind of out of place as though I didn't know anything and so forth. But I was given the most wonderful kind of help, which is nearly invisible. And it's only afterwards thinking about it that I realized how much help I had gotten.
Indeed. Indeed. Would it be impertinent for me to ask you what you're currently working on?
I'm working on, and this has been, I'm now into the third revision of a memoir. It's called Little Brother. It's based on the life of my younger brother, Jonathan Bingham, who died rather mysteriously in his early 20s. And I was fortunate enough to have, through the kindness of my sister, what few papers had been collected during his brief lifetime, as well as the journal of his last 3 months at Harvard before he dropped out. My inspiration for doing this was years of wondering what had happened to my little brother. And also, I know some of you remember the character of Quentin Compson in Faulkner's The Sound and the Fury. There are many parallels between my brother Jonathan's life and the life of this fictional character, Quentin Compson. And in fact, I was astonished to learn during my research, these both the fictional character and my brother went to Harvard, that there's a bridge over the Charles River at Cambridge with a plaque that commemorates the death of Quentin Compson, this fictional character who drowned himself there, as the plaque says, in the odor of magnolias. There's a lot to be said that hasn't been said or written about the fate of young people growing up in the South, even now, and then plunged into a much different, much more varied, much more demanding situation in the North. Some people thrive on it, thank God, because it's the way it should be. Other people are really overwhelmed and eventually even destroyed by it. This book is looking for a publisher right now, so I don't know how long, particularly in the present turmoil, it's going to be before it finds a home, but I'm sure it will find a home one of these days.
I hope so. The other question that I prepared is actually about the present turmoil and about how amazingly generative this kind of turmoil can be and has been for artists. And I wonder, as an artist yourself, if you find that the experience of the quarantine and the other aspects of our current life, shall we say, have been generative for you as an artist.
It has been generative, and I sort of hate to say that, because for many people, for most people, this has been a disaster. My income has not been affected by it. My job has not been snatched away from me. I have health insurance if I should get sick, which I haven't been, thank God. Really, the positive part of it for me is that it's a lot more time for reflection. I've always spent a lot of time alone, so that's not really an issue. But when there's so much going on, as there is in what we used to think was normal, a lot of that reflection is preoccupation with daily issues and people and so on. It's opened up my imagination in a way that's very useful to me. The loss, particularly for a short story writer, the loss is in all those daily meetings, not necessarily even with friends, seeing people on the street, sitting down in a coffee shop and eavesdropping on a conversation. All these things are little seeds for short stories. So I do miss that. I do miss that. But that will eventually come back again. I don't know in what shape or form, because I think we are bound to be profoundly changed by this experience, as we should be.
I absolutely, absolutely agree. Well, Sallie, I want to thank you so much for being with us today. We look forward to our times together. I wish that we were together in the same room, but I feel almost as if we are right now. And I think the rest of the folks here today also feel that intimacy that you are able to create even through Zoom. So I want to thank you. And I think I represent everybody in the Zoom room when I say congratulations on these books. And we wish you all health and safety.
Thank you, Laura, and the same to you and to everyone who's participated today. It's a great gift to me.